Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Tightrope Walker by Dorothy Gilman, narrated by Ruth Ann Phimister. This work is copyrighted 1979 by Dorothy Gilman Butters. This recording is copyrighted 1999 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Amelia Jones has just become the owner of the Ebb Tide Shop, a musty antique store filled with merry-go-round horses and hurdy-gurdies. Buried deep inside one of these, she finds a mysterious message, a horrifying one at that. And so begins a journey into the past, where nothing is the way it seems, where fear is second nature, and where dark secrets just might uncover murder. And now, Tightrope Walker.
Part 1. The important thing is to carry the sun with you, inside of you at every moment against the darkness, for there will be a great and terrifying darkness. From the maze in the heart of the castle. Chapter 1. Maybe everyone lives with terror every minute of every day and buries it, never stopping long enough to look. Or maybe it's just me. I'm speaking here of your ordinary basic terrors, like the meaning of life, or what if there's no meaning at all? Or what if somebody pushes the red alert button? Or the economy collapses and we turn into ravaging beasts fighting over food, not to mention the noises in an old house when boards creak and things go bump in the night. Sometimes I think we're all tightrope walkers, suspended on a wire 2,000 feet in the air. And so long as we never look down, we're okay. But some of us lose momentum and look down for a second and are never quite the same again. We know. That's why when I found the note hidden in the old hurdy-gurdy, I didn't take it as a joke. I could smell the terror in the words even before I'd finished reading the first sentence. They're going to kill me soon. In a few hours, I think. And somehow they'll arrange it so no one will ever guess I was murdered. But perhaps I'd better explain about the hurdy-gurdy and why at my age, which is 22, I am not out in the world setting it on fire, figuratively speaking, or graduating from Wellesley or Bryn Mawr, or doing any of those normal upper-middle-class things, but instead own and tend the Ebb Tide Shop, Treasures and Junk, Amelia Jones' proprietor, 688 Fleet Street, not your best section of town. Actually, it's because I'm so free, a word I use loosely and not without irony. Due to circumstances I won't go into at the moment, I have been quite alone in the world since I was 18, and with a rather strange childhood under my belt as well. When I was 17, my father packed me off to a psychiatrist named Dr. Merivale. I think my father knew he was going to die soon, and one day he looked across the room and saw me, really saw me, perhaps for the first time, and he thought, good God. So off I went to Dr. Merivale, who was supposed to inject confidence and character into me in prescribed doses, 3 times a week at $45 an hour. And a few months after I'd begun seeing Dr. Merivale, my father went to the hospital with his last heart attack and died. He left a rather surprising amount of money to be doled out to me month by month until I was 21 by the First National Bank downtown. I think he hoped that Dr. Merivale would assume some kind of responsibility for me. I continued visiting Dr. Merivale for 2 years, at first out of sheer inertia, having nothing else in my life, but gradually I began to grow interested in what he was trying to do. Actually, it was like going to college, except that while other girls were studying Jung and Freud out of textbooks in class, I was collecting dreams for Dr. Merivale, learning the difference between superego and id, discovering that I came from a trauma-ridden family and that I was terrified of life. I crammed just like a student, reading books on psychology all day and half the night. It had an effect. One day I looked in a full-length mirror and realized why nobody had ever noticed me. I shouldn't have noticed me either in an oversized gray sweater with stretched sleeves and a gray skirt with a crooked hem. I went out and bought a pair of bell-bottom slacks, which were in style at that time, and a bright pink shirt and a pair of sandals. The bell-bottoms swished when I walked, and I liked that. The next week I bought a white sweater and then a blue one. One day I accused Dr. Merivale of being a stuffed shirt, heady stuff. He was really very pleased with me after he'd recovered from the initial shock. I can't say I blossomed physically. I was still thin and freckle-faced with straight brown hair, but inside I was coming to life. I could almost forgive my mother for hanging herself when I was 11. After the big house on Walnut Street was sold, I moved into a boarding house. Dr. Merivale insisted I be among people and fell into a very growth-oriented regime because I wanted to change as fast as possible. I set the alarm clock for 8, rose and did deep breathing exercises, then transcendental meditation for 20 minutes, and after that, half an hour of yoga followed by 30 minutes of Canadian Air Force calisthenics, aimed mostly, I have to confess, at increasing my bust measurement. Sometimes it was almost noon before I had breakfast. And 3 times a week I went to Dr. Merivale, and I hung mottos all over the walls of my room like, "I am the master of my destiny and the captain of my soul." But I still had nightmares every night. It was at the boarding house that I met Callie Monahan, who had freckles too. What struck me first about him was his great calmness. He couldn't have been older than 30. He had a red beard and red hair, and every evening after dinner he would remain behind at the table and peel an apple, slowly and very intently. I knew nothing about him except his name and that he played the guitar. Sometimes I would hear him practicing in his room, which was above mine, sweet, lonely songs like Red River Valley and Where Have All the Flowers Gone? After about 3 weeks, we said hello when we met on the stairs. I was feeling quite daring by that time. And after a few more weeks, I stopped going into a panic when he said, "How are you?" And one evening after dinner, we actually had a conversation. He wanted to know what I did in my room all day. I rather incoherently stammered out an explanation. It didn't occur to me to dissemble. And he said, "So what does this doctor do for you?" I said he was trying to free me. "From what and for what?" he asked pleasantly, looking up from his apple peeling. I turned scarlet, and then after a moment said defiantly, "Well, for one thing, I've learned I have an IQ of 140, and that frees me from feeling stupid, which is the way I've felt all my life." He looked at me for a long time, gravely, without amusement, which was merciful. And he seemed to be making up his mind about something. He said at last, quietly, "You'd better come and meet Aman Singh." What's strange about this is that after he took me to meet Aman Singh that evening, I never saw Callie Monahan again, which always reminds me of Jung's speculations about meaningful coincidences in our lives, because if it weren't for Callie Monahan, I would never have met Aman Singh. I would probably have joined the typing class that Dr. Merivale kept urging on me, and I would certainly never have found the note in the hurdy-gurdy. Sometimes I ask myself, would anyone else have discovered it? And if they did, would they have cared or done anything about it and changed the lives of so many people? It's things like this that comfort me when I feel frightened about life. I was very nervous about going out for the evening with a young man, and quite unable to decide whether it was a date or not, so I compromised and wore the old gray sweater with the bell-bottoms, half old life, half new. From somewhere, Callie Monahan produced a motorcycle. I hadn't known he had that. And off we roared through the streets of the city with me hanging on for dear life. In spite of having lived all my life in Trafton, I'd never visited Clancy Street before or even seen it. It was in the oldest section of town, a narrow street lined with decaying old houses, funny little shops, and a few stalls set out on the sidewalks. We parked in front of a grimy wooden house with a lopsided front porch, climbed 5 flights of stairs to a grimy hall, and walked into Aman Singh's room. The room was dim and not very clean, and he was the oldest man I think I've ever seen. And yet, his skin was the color of coffee and cream, with a network of fine lines crisscrossing it everywhere. Not wrinkles so much as lines like filigree lace. He glanced at me just once as we came in, and I saw that his eyes were black, really black, like ink or a raven's wing or a black pearl, and so soft, so luminous, they seemed to melt all over his face. When he looked at me, I felt something inside of me melt too. He sat cross-legged on the floor like a Buddha in pajamas. Several people were crouched uncomfortably around him, talking a language I couldn't understand. We sat down and waited. Being here struck me as weird and a little scary, and yet I felt a sense of peacefulness flowing over me. It seemed to come from Aman Singh, his voice for one thing, so soft, almost whispering as he replied to the others. And then, of course, those luminous, kind eyes. I felt he wasn't trying to please anyone or demand anything. He was simply there. And the others adjusted themselves to hear him. It was about 10 minutes before he turned to Callie and said, "You have brought a friend." "Yes." His eyes rested lightly on me. "We have been speaking of violence." "Oh," I said. "The violence inside us all, the angers, the negative thoughts, the resentments and greeds." I nodded politely. He said in his soft, whispery voice, his eyes kind, "When you entered this room, I felt your violence." Now, if there is one thing I felt I was not at that time, it was violent. I was soft, malleable, shy, and timid, and having doggedly visited Dr. Merivale for 2 years, I determined to assert myself. I said indignantly, "After all, who was this creepy old man who looked like a high lama in Lost Horizon?" "But I don't have violence in me. My psychiatrist is trying to teach anger to me. He says I don't want enough for myself." Aman Singh listened with his head cocked like a bird, and then he said in his soft sing-song voice, "Always, how blind we are to ourselves." "How?" I gasped. His eyes met mine and held them. "A tree may be bent by harsh winds," he said softly, "but it is no less beautiful than the tree that grows in a sheltered nook, and often it bears the richer fruit. In your desperate longing to be like others, to be like everyone else, you seek to destroy what may be a song one day." I sat, astonished. Of course I understood him at once. What he said was true. Of course it was true. I wanted above all else to be, well, normal, homogenized, pretty, popular, not lonely. I had accepted my longing as logical and sane. It was what Dr. Merivale wanted for me, and it was what I wanted for myself. Now suddenly all my exercises and calisthenics and galvanizing mottos looked like little straitjackets I'd cut out and made for myself. I couldn't decide whether this funny little man was hypnotizing me or waking me up from a long sleep, and it was terribly important to know. I sat staring at him, and then I stood up and walked out. I left without a word to either Callie or to Aman Singh, and I walked alone back to the boarding house, went into my room, closed the door, and stayed there for 2 days. On the evening of the second day, I suddenly burst out laughing. The next morning, I telephoned Dr. Merivale and told him that I wouldn't be coming in to see him for a while, and then I tore down all the mottos from my wall and packed away all but a few of my books. I began to walk around town just looking at people and flowers and things. Sometimes I would stop in to see Aman Singh, and he would make herb tea, and we would sit very quietly and drink it. Once in a while, but rarely he would tell me a story, but not often, because there didn't seem any need for words between us. When he asked me what I was doing, I said I was waiting, and he nodded. And then one day, 2 blocks from Aman Singh's room, on the street that bisected it, I saw this merry-go-round horse in the window of a shop, and I stopped, transfixed. I stared at its lines, at the rakish tilt of its bridled head, and a deep sense of pleasure lifted my heart and made it light and full of music. It was the first time in my life I'd felt an emotion that was all mine, and the first time I'd admired something not influenced or colored by someone else's words and tastes and thoughts. I went into the shop, which was called the Ebbtide Shop, and I bought the merry-go-round horse from the gnarled little man inside. It was delivered to my room, and I spent the loveliest week of my life regilding and painting the horse, which I named, of course, Pegasus. And incredibly, for that entire week, I slept without a nightmare. Unfortunately, the next week, there was a second merry-go-round horse in the window of the Ebbtide Shop, coal black this time with a scarlet saddle. And since my room measured only 15 by 15, it was obvious that I couldn't buy this one, too. I went inside to admire it, though, and to explain to Mr. George Arrakis why I'd have to pass this one up. He said it didn't matter to him because his business was for sale, and a merry-go-round horse in the window was a good advertisement, and 4 in the basement was even better. For the first time, I became aware that I had turned 21 and had money. I asked him how much he was asking for his shop. He said he had a long-term lease on the building, which was high and narrow, with a 2-room apartment upstairs, and in the basement a storeroom and delivery platform. For the business itself, he was asking $12,000. I bought the shop that same day, bought it lock, stock, and barrel, and without haggling. Its more valuable stock consisted of 5 merry-go-round horses, 2 player pianos, 3 antique dolls, a jukebox, piles of old clothes, and a hurdy-gurdy. I scrubbed and swept and painted, had a new sign made for outside, and hung blue and white striped curtains on gold rings at the back of the window. What I could not do was discipline the overwhelming amount of junk that Mr. George Arrakis had bought in cases and cartons and by the dozen. If I threw it out, there'd be almost nothing left in the shop, and so I cut prices and hoped it would move slowly and steadily out of the door in the hands of customers. The hurdy-gurdy I didn't find until later, after I'd moved in upstairs, because it was covered with burlap and stood in a dark corner of the shop. It was a beautiful hurdy-gurdy, in mint condition for its age. It stood on a sturdy maple stick, and the strap for carrying it was only a little frayed. The box itself was glorious, a faded Chinese red with gold edging, and in the center was this bright, rather corny painting of towering blue Alps, a river gorge, and a cream-colored sky, very Rousseau. When I turned the crank, there was a creak and then a twang, and the instrument actually began to play Tales from the Vienna Woods. After that came a second tune. A faded slip of paper glued to the side told me that it was Sonata No. 1 from Vivaldi's Il Pastor Fido, and this was followed by the Blue Danube Waltz. I knew I couldn't part with this. I carried it upstairs to the apartment and began playing it evenings when I wasn't teaching myself how to play the banjo or doing accounts. One evening, about 3 weeks later, the hurdy-gurdy crank got stuck and refused to budge, silencing the Blue Danube Waltz on its second note. I found a screwdriver and pried open the back panel, which fitted loosely anyway, and that's when I discovered that a folded slip of paper had slowly worked its way down toward the working mechanism. It was this that had brought it to a halt. I carefully lifted out the wad of paper with a pair of eyebrow tweezers and tried the crank again. It moved smoothly, and the Blue Danube Waltz resumed playing at once. I screwed the panel back into place, and only then noticed the slip of paper I'd tossed on the floor. I picked it up, smoothed it out to see what it might be, and met with a terror far worse than my own. I read, "They're going to kill me soon, in a few hours, I think, and somehow they'll arrange it so no one will ever guess I was murdered. Why did I sign that paper last night? I was so hungry and tired, but this morning I knew I should never have signed it. Whatever it was my death warrant. But to die so strangely, a prisoner in my own house. Why hasn't someone come? What have these two clever, faceless ones told Nora, or even Robin, to explain my silence? Never mind. What has to be faced now is death. Perhaps I could hide these words somewhere in a different place, in the hope that one day someone will find them. That would make death less lonely. And so, should anyone ever find this, my name is Hannah." The last letter collapsed under my eyes, the H ending in a long, shaken stroke that dropped several inches below the line, as if the pen had slipped, as if a voice had been heard or a step approaching. I pictured this unknown Hannah trembling, as I was trembling now, folding up this paper, holding it a moment, wide-eyed as she looked around a room for a hiding place. And then the quick move to the hurdy-gurdy with its loose back panel and the slipping of it through the crack. What kind of person would own a hurdy-gurdy? The paper on which the words were written was faded, but it was the kind of cheap yellow paper you can buy in any stationery store. A ream of it for $2 or $3, called seconds. Cheap yellow fades fast, so that didn't mean a great deal. The handwriting looked sensible, and it was certainly legible, even if the words ran together a little toward the end. There was that paragraph, too. I didn't think I would have bothered with a paragraph if I knew I was going to be murdered any minute. The handwriting was a little small, but not cramped. What kind of person was this? I wanted to know. My wanting was so strong it astonished me. Sometimes, when I'm in a certain mood, I've looked at life from a great distance, like peering at it through the small end of a pair of binoculars, and I wonder about it. The whole business seems very strange to me. Just one shot at 80 years and 10, and for what? I mean, there has to be a reason for being here. Even no reason is a reason. One of Aman Singh's stories is that we're on this planet because there are gods and demons in the universe who are numb to feeling, and so they send us here to watch our antics and feel violence through us vicariously, because it's violence that feeds them and keeps them alive. And the only way to escape being eaten, as he calls it, is to study violent emotions, detach oneself from them, and so cheat the gods and demons. Well, why not? People do seem to make such a botch of living, killing and squabbling and rejecting and hating, as if life's some kind of toy to play with or destroy. Somehow we all end up victims, and the horror of it is that we're victims of each other. And now I was meeting another victim. What kind of paper had they wanted her to sign? She couldn't still be alive. The hurdy-gurdy had been mine for several weeks, and before that it had belonged to Mr. Georgiorakis. This woman didn't know me, and I didn't know her. But she must have gone to her death thinking about me, taking comfort from the thought that she had left these words behind her and that someone would find them. It said so right here. That would make death less lonely. She wouldn't mean death itself. She would mean those frightening moments just before it happens, when a person feels nakedly alone and unknowing. She must have clung to the thought of me then as one last final hope, a small candle flame in her midnight. How had they kidded her, these people she called the clever faceless ones? Had they really managed her death so that no one knew she'd been murdered? Would that be possible? I placed the piece of yellow paper on the table and walked into the kitchen and poured water into a pan and measured instant coffee into a mug. I felt really shaken, finding a thing like that in the hurdy-gurdy. The old clock on the shelf told me that it was 10:30. It was so quiet in these two rooms over the shop that I could hear each tick, like a heart beating. And then a truck passed on the street outside and blurred the silence. The kitchen was very plain, oilcloth tacked to the wall behind the sink, and scruffy linoleum on the floor. No countertop, but a long old wooden table with knife cuts on it scrubbed clean, an ancient gas stove, two sets of homemade wooden shelves for groceries and dishes, and a really decadent refrigerator that snored peacefully for days and then suddenly vibrated wildly until I gave it a kick and put it to sleep again. The bath was off the short passage to the living room and very much the same. Coffee in hand, I returned to the living room, carefully avoiding the slip of yellow paper that I could see waiting for me out of the corner of my eye. The coffee grounded me. It returned me to the present. So did Pegasus, standing guard next to my couch bed, his head high and mane flying. I went to one of the two windows and opened it and looked out. The street was silent and empty, but not dark. This was a street where other people lived over shops, too. The family across the street who ran the second-hand bookshop, the dressmaker next to them, the nearly new clothes shop beyond, and the palmist, Madam Helen, above that. The lights were bright squares. One by one, I watched them extinguished. I thought, there must be some way to find out who wrote that note. Don't be ridiculous, scoffed the contrary half of me. It could have been written years ago, and she didn't even give her name. She gave half of it. You think she gave half of it. It could just as easily have been written by a man named Hannesberg or some such. But the note was written. It doesn't matter by whom. Yes, and the person who wrote it is probably walking around alive and sound at this very minute. Don't be a fool. If she's alive, then why didn't she recover the note and tear it up? Too much trouble, of course. The nightmare was over. I'm familiar with nightmares, I pointed out dryly, and they are not ended so easily. She wouldn't have forgotten that note. Then if you believe she's dead, what's the point of trying to find out anything about her? It's a responsibility. Don't be a fool. Dr. Merivale said you're much too imaginative. And don't forget that streak of the morbid in you. Next you'll be saying it's a hand reaching out to you from the grave. There's nothing grave-like about that letter, I argued. I think she valued life, and I admire that. And she addressed the note to me. She wrote it to whoever found it, and I found it, didn't I? And there's no one else to care. Then you just might tell me what you think you can do. And of course, I hadn't the slightest idea. I turned from the window and looked at the room behind me. In this room, I'd affected my environment, as Dr. Merivale would phrase it. He was always urging me to affect my environment. I'd sanded the bumpy old plaster walls and painted them off white, and a man had come in with a machine to refinish the hardwood floor. It was a room that pleased me very much. There was Pegasus rearing up beside the couch, a buffet print on the wall, a yellow beanbag chair, a thick rug in primary colors, a number of plants hanging from the ceiling in rope bags, and of course the hurdy-gurdy against the wall beside my banjo. This room was my cocoon now. Its shining white walls and bright colors were what gave my downstairs life in the shop a lovely dimension. I didn't want to lose the sensuous delight of creating more of this. I hadn't even begun on the kitchen. I didn't want to turn my attention elsewhere, which I would have to do if I went plunging out into the world to look for a woman who had written that she was going to be murdered, and who was probably dead now anyway. Where would a person begin if they decided to look? I filled my garden sprayer with water and walked around absentmindedly spraying my plants for the second time that day. After that, I placed Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto on the phonograph and lay on the floor and listened to it. And when that ended, it was midnight, and I fooled around a little with the banjo, plunking out "She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain" and "Little Maggie." Attention is a funny thing. When I meditate, I can concentrate on an imaginary candle flame and reach a point where I see all kinds of lovely flashing lights on the periphery. That's what I was doing now, concentrating on the banjo and hoping I'd find something off on the side. But already in the pit of my stomach, I knew that I was going to do something. I had to. Don't ask me why. At 2 o'clock, I turned off the light and climbed into bed and lay down, and then I got up and turned on the light again and looked up 2 addresses in the phone book, one of them in the yellow pages. Feeling better, I set the alarm clock and returned to bed. I had expected to toss and turn, and frankly, I'd expected a nightmare or two, at the very least, that hand reaching up to me from the grave. But I slept soundly and serenely until the alarm woke me at 7. Chapter 2. Mr. Georgiakis met me with a scowl at the door of his apartment. He was wearing one of the Indian blanket bathrobes from the shop, which he must have bought in volume years ago because there were still a dozen left, and the price changes on their tags were as long as a grocery receipt, moving from $12.99 to $2, all with artistic slashes. I can't say that the garish colors did much for Mr. Georgiakis's figure, which was shaped like a Chianti bottle. His considerable weight having dropped between his hips like a woman in the last month of pregnancy, leaving him a thin man at the top and a plump one at the bottom, it made for an interesting line. He gave me a baleful stare. "I warned you, business was slow. You can't tell me I deceived you." I hurried to explain that I hadn't come to complain, but to ask about the hurdy-gurdy. And by the time I'd finished explaining, I realized I'd taken him much too seriously. He was looking amused, a twinkle in his eyes, as if he found me very funny. "Come in and sit," he said. "Sit and have a cup of coffee. You took the stairs too fast. You're too young for a fifth-floor walk-up. Only old men like me can manage such a climb." "How do you manage it?" I asked. "Slowly, like a climb up the Matterhorn. Sugar? Cream?" "Black," I told him, "and thank you very much, Mr. Georgiakis." He peered at me from under his heavy gray brows. "You're a very polite young woman, Miss Jones. Loosen up a little. You'll live longer." "I'm trying," I told him. "Try harder. Now, what's this about the hurdy-gurdy?"
I'd worked out what I felt was a convincing little story. If politeness was my severest affliction at that time, it was also, I'd found, a very good smokescreen for telling a lie. Nobody doubts anyone who's polite. It implies a tremendous respect for authority. I told him that a customer was very interested in buying the hurdy-gurdy, but first wanted to learn its history from the original owner. "I'm hoping you can remember who you bought it from so I can trace it," I told him.
"Remember? No," he said.
Damn, I thought, and suddenly realized how much this had begun to mean to me.
"But look it up, I can," he said, blowing into his cup of steaming coffee.
"Look it up?" I said dazedly. "You mean you have records?"
He gave me a reproachful glance. "These I offered to you at the lawyer's office. You should yourself keep records because of the police. Sometimes things that people sell are hot, stolen, illegal."
I vaguely remembered his saying something about this.
At the time, it had seemed unlikely that anything in the shop was worth more of a fuss than the bathrobes marked down from $12.99 to $2. But I had been grateful for the names of the auction houses at which he'd found the merry-go-round horses, and had let it go at that. Then do you mean there really is a possibility? My hopes, which had nosedived, crawled up one rung of the ladder and hung there, waiting for his reply. He shrugged his thin shoulders. Maybe yes, maybe no. Getting to his feet, he opened a door in the passageway to the front door and went into another room. I heard the murmur of a woman's voice, which surprised me because at the time I bought the shop from him, he was definitely not married. Maybe he still wasn't. It gave Mr. Georgiarakis a new and interesting facet. A minute later, he padded back, closing the door behind him and carrying a black notebook. It was 6, maybe 8 months ago, he said, thumbing through the pages, and nodded. You're in luck. Sometimes a customer gets huffy about leaving a name, but this one I knew. One hurdy-gurdy, $100, November 9, Oliver Keene. He's been in before, usually to sell me paintings when he's broke. Painter chap. Buys old costumes for his models, too, when he's in the chips. I don't know where he lives. Oliver Keene, I repeated. I took out the small spiral notebook I'd bought on the way and copied down the name, my heart beating faster at this triumph. I really felt pleased. I couldn't forget the horrified feeling that had struck me when I thought for that moment that Mr. Georgiarakis couldn't help me. I said, "This is wonderful. I really appreciate it." Putting away my notebook, I asked innocently, "You live alone here, Mr. Georgiarakis?" After all, the hurdy-gurdy had been in his possession for 6 months, and I wasn't taking any chances. He rolled his eyes heavenward. If I lived alone, would I sell you my business? Of course not. For 10 years, I climbed these 5 flights courting Katina. With $12,000, she marries me. His twinkle was back. He was really a funny man now that I understood his deadpan humor. That's very nice, I said, walking to the door with him. I hope you and Mrs. Georgiarakis will be very happy. I thanked him again and left, heading at once for the telephone kiosk at the corner where I looked through the K's. There was an Oliver Keene living on Danson Street, and I copied down the address. After that, I went to the post office and Xeroxed 2 copies of Hannah's note and carried them to the park where I sat down on a bench. I'd brought scissors with me. I took one of the Xerox copies and cut out parts of 2 sentences. I was so tired and hungry, but this morning I know. And then, should anyone ever find this, my name is Hannah. After doing this, I walked back to Fleet Street. It was just 9 o'clock, and there were no customers waiting for the shop to open. I hung a back-at-noon sign on the door and walked south to find 901 Fleet Street, the address I'd looked up in the Yellow Pages the night before. I would never have thought of consulting a graphologist if I hadn't passed the sign innumerable times on my way to Aman Singh's. I'd noticed it months before, and out of curiosity I'd looked up the word in the dictionary just to be sure. The study of handwriting, it said, for the purpose of character analysis. In the Yellow Pages, the man sounded professional, Joseph Osborne, followed by the word accredited, whatever that meant, or by whom, and consultant. I was hoping he could tell me something about the person who'd written the note. A distance of 6 blocks in a city can make as much difference as Dante walking in or out of his inferno. My block on Fleet Street was a bazaar full of second-hand this and that's, uncertain whether collapse or renewal lay ahead for it. Surprisingly prim in its values, still relatively crime-free, but hanging on by the skin of its teeth. On sunny days, the block looked picturesque. On rainy days, forlorn, it trod a very narrow line. The 900 block had an uncanny resemblance to the 600 block, except that it had been shored up, laundered, dipped in paint until it sparkled, and I could guess that its rents were triple that of mine.
It even had a few trees, not very old yet, planted among the cobbles. Joseph P. Osborne, graphologist, was on the second floor of 901, over a doctor's office that occupied the first floor. I walked up steps that grew progressively shabbier and dustier, until by the time I reached the second floor, I felt quite at home. On the landing, I was met by three doors, all wide open, one to a lavatory, another to an office with desk and chairs, the third a sunny back room that to my practiced eye was obviously J. Osborne's living quarters. Since the office was empty, I knocked on the open door in the middle and peered inside. A muffled voice said, "Who is it?" The voice seemed to come from a sort of tent occupying the middle of the room. At least I couldn't think what else it could be, since it was about 5 feet high, came to a point like a teepee, and had a sheet loosely thrown over it. It was at this moment that I felt a prescient stab of terror at what I was getting into. It simply hadn't occurred to me, it really hadn't, that this quixotic search of mine was going to mean knocking on strange doors and meeting people, in this case someone under a sheet. I remembered Dr. Merivale's speeches on affecting my environment, and Amon Singh's gentle fables about letting go, and their words felt like balloon captions over my head that came together and exploded. I wondered if the man under the tent had heard the explosion. I stopped trembling and said crisply, "Amelia Jones needing information, please." The sheet stirred, one corner was lifted, and J. Osborne crawled out and stood up. "It's early," he said accusingly. "You shouldn't just walk in." "I knocked," I reminded him. He wasn't much older than I was, and I wasn't sure he was J. Osborne. He was wearing blue jeans and no shoes and a wrinkled denim shirt. He had a nice, open, boyish face, with the skin very taut over its bones, which were arranged into interesting angles. He had dark hair and blue eyes, and a thin, intense look about him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.